In the last lecture, so on 26, you must have had an introduction of what is the concept of cobotics, and also a brief introduction of on the dynamics of robots. Okay, but now, so what you had an idea of how any signal, any actuation signal, or any force that is applied to one of the joints of the robot is going to translate into the ultimate position of the robot. Okay, but what's the use of this knowledge? And unless you can utilize it to make the robot do something that you want. Okay, so but if you want to make the robot do your bidding, you need to understand the robotic system. Okay, so you have a robot here, and since you need the robot to achieve a goal, you should first know what the goal is. Okay, the goal can be that the robot goes to some position, so you should be able to measure the position of the robot. So for that you need some sensors which acts like the sense organs. Okay, or probably you need the robot to pick something up or apply some force, so you should know what the environment, you should also have an idea of what the environment the robot is in. Of course, when you want to apply a force or some torque to the joints of the robot, you need some actuators to do this. You need some muscle. Okay, so you need an actuator, and to be able to make sense of what should be the signal that should be given to the actuator, what should be the force that should be applied, what should be the torque that should be applied at the joints, you need some other unit which will act like the brain of the entire system. Okay, so basically what you need is you need a robotic system, okay, that basically acts like a human being. Okay, so what you need is a robotic system. Now has three components. One is the sensors which act like the sense organs, one is the actuator which acts like the muscle of the robot, and a control block, a controller, which acts like the brain. Now the dependencies that we have here are that the sensor will try to find out what is the details about what are the parameters of the robot. Okay, we'll look into that in detail a little later, and also make sense of what the environment is. Okay, on the other side, the actuator, the muscle of the robot, may influence some factors of the robot, or it may also be that it influences the entire environment in which the robot is functioning in. And of course the controller will act like the brain of the robot. Okay, so now these details as such may not really make sense. Now let me again go into each of these particular blocks. First, let us look at the sensors. Okay, so what the hell has happened? Okay, now the sensors, as I said, will act like the sense organs of the robot. Okay, and as I said, that the sensors can be such that they either try to find some of the parameters of the robot itself or some of the parameters of the environment. Okay, so let's try to, so what we have is it should act like a sense organ. So either it, so you can have cameras which sees the environment, okay, and provides computer vision which acts like the eyes of a robot, or you can also have something called as a load cell, which now acts like the skin, which gives a tactile sensation, so that you will be able to figure out how much force is applied to the robot or how much force is applied by the robot. Okay, so these are two things. They are external sensors because they have to interact with the external environment, with the environment around the robot, to get the sensor information. So when you say that there are external sensors, there should also be something called as internal sensors. Okay, so you also have position encoders, okay, which act like internal sensors. Now, what do you mean by internal sensing? Can there be something which doesn't interact with the environment, which doesn't, can the position of the robot be sensibly measured without caring about what the environment the robot is working in? Does it really happen in our sense also, in the case of humans also? Okay, so the equivalent concept to this internal sensing is something that is called as proprioception. And let me try to put that in words, in the sense that let us say you closed your eyes and you want to know whether you are lying down or you are sitting up or you are standing. Is that possible? Of course, it's something that is trivial. You don't need to look out to understand whether what the position of your own body. Okay, so something similar can be done in the robotic system also, where some of the factors of the environment are constant, and taking advantage of that fact, the robot can find its own position, can sense its own position without actually interacting with the environment. Okay, let's look at each of those cases. Okay, now the first case that I talked about was robotic vision, that is the use of camera. Here is one type of a camera which is called as an eye-in-hand camera, where you have this end effector of the robot and a camera attached to the end effector. Now, in this case, in an assembly line that we have here, so these two robots need, one of the robots needs to stack the ICs that are coming in, and the other needs to place it on this conveyor belt. Okay. Now, to do this, there are cameras mounted at this end effectors of the robot, and they try to find the position and orientation of these IC chips, which are now in the environment. They are not part of the robot. Okay. And these cameras are now used, and of course, there's an algorithm that tries to position the robot appropriately, and the robot picks and places it. Okay, so the camera now acts as a sensor in this case. Okay, the other thing that I had talked about is the tactile sensation, and I had said that we use something called as a load cell. Okay, and what is being done here is the force that has to be measured. So the force that is provided, that is being given by the robot, that is being measured, so that an appropriate action can be taken. Okay. Now, let me explain in a bit detail about what this load cell is. This load cell is basically a electrical circuit in which there are a number of resistors here. Okay. These resistors are called as the strain gauges. Okay. And the peculiarity of these resistors is that when you apply force to this, okay, this element on which the resistors are mounted, so when a force is applied, it will cause deformation in these four resistors. Okay, so when you say deformation, what is happening is that the length of the resistor is changing. Excuse me. Yeah, the length of the resistor is changing, and since the length of the resistor is changing, the resistance will also change, because resistance is given by rho L by A. Okay, length is changing, probably the cross-sectional area is also changing. So the effective resistance is changing. Now, the fun part is that the resistance of two of these would increase and when applying a force, and simultaneously the resistance of the other two are decreasing. So that can be seen in the second slide, the second picture, that when a force is applied here, two of these values are increasing and two of these values are decreasing. Okay, and now this is powered by a voltage source, and so there is a voltage drop, or there is a voltage across these two terminals. Okay, now if so, the measurement of this voltage is indirectly giving a measurement of the amount of force that is being applied. Now this can be now interpreted as a tactile sensation, as a sensor that is trying to find out how much force is being applied. Okay, and this sort of seems abstract, so let us look an example as a video of an example in which this is actually being done. Okay, now there are two robots here. They are trying to interact with one another, collaborate, and try to plug in this cable into this port. Okay, now what is happening is that as long as this cable is loose, no force is seen at the end effector here. So as soon as this cable becomes taut, there is a force that is experienced by this robot, and so it leaves the it sort of ungrips the cable. Okay, and now afterwards, after that point, what is happening here is that this robot comes to this particular position on top of the iPhone or iPod, and then tries to plug in this cable. Okay, tries to plug in that plug into the port in the iPod. But now, how much distance should this go from this position to whatever position it is going down? What should be this distance? Okay, that can't be known a priori. Okay, because how sure are we that this iPod is not moving when a force is applied? Okay, when you try to plug in, you are giving a force onto the surface of the iPod. Okay, so that can cause a small motion in the iPod. So what should be done is that this robot should keep on moving until the plug is completely plugged in, which means that there is a particular amount of reaction force that is experienced by this end effector, or this robot, the second robot. Okay, so basically there are two things that are happening here. That is, there is a position control from here to here, and a position based control from here to here, and there is a force based control from in the vertical direction. Okay, so I'll come to this same setup a little later in the presentation. Okay, but let's remember there is a position based control and there is a force based action that is performed here. And so now we have seen vision and we have seen tactile sensation. So the third one is the measurement of internal measurement of position and acceleration. Okay, that what I said as proprioception. Okay, so this is best suited when you are pretty sure that the environment in which the robot is operating is almost constant. Okay, and we need to know only the internal position or acceleration or velocity of the robots, of different components of the robots. Okay, so when you say position, one of the simplest sensors that can be used for measurement of position are optical encoders. Okay. So it is the simple thing is that there is an LED here, there is a disc, a slotted disc here, and there is a photodetector on the other side. So when the slotted disc is moving, the light that is incident on this photodetector, photosensor, is going to come in pulses. Okay, and the number of pulses basically gives the number of slots that are passed. So number of slots that have passed is anyway directly related to the amount of turn or the position of the of that particular of this disk itself. Okay, so the frequency of this pulse train would give the velocity, and the number of pulses, okay, gives the position. Okay, but there is one problem with this. Okay, let us say that you measure that there are 100 pulses that have passed. Okay, now what you know is that this 100 pulses, after 100 pulses, the position is initial position plus some 100 steps. Okay, but unless you are sure of what the initial position is, you are not sure of the current position. Okay, so this sort of a setup where you start from initial position and you measure the number of pulses is called as an integrating encoder. Okay, the construction is quite simple in this case. However, the problem is that you need to know what is the initial position of it, of that encoder itself. Okay, on the other hand, you have absolute encoder, which are displayed here, where you have a color coded disk here. Okay, and the pattern in each of these section is always different, and depending upon, and you need multiple photo detectors here. Okay, depending upon this, the combination or the pattern that is incident, you exactly know what is the position of the of this disk, in which, what position in 360 degrees is the disk currently in. So that is an absolute encoding or absolute optical encoder. Okay, now this, we have seen the position. What about velocity? Position itself, we have another. So this is a digital case, digital method of measuring position. You can also have an analog measurement of position by using a potentiometer. So you have a voltage supply, okay, that is connected across a resistance, and you have a wiper here, okay, which is connected across these two terminals. So what you are basically measuring here is this section versus this entire section. Okay, so basically what you are measuring is the position again. The advantage of that is that this would give a more granular, more precise measurement of position. However, this sort of a voltage based or an analog based measurement is not very conducive to the further processing, because now this analog signal has to be anyway converted to a digital signal if you want to feed it into any algorithm. So this, though precise, has its own disadvantages. You know, let's move on. So in addition to these position sensors, we also have other sensors like proximity sensors, which are IR based sensors, which say whether the robot has approached. This is basically more useful in case of mobile robot, where I know, where I want to actually see whether the robot is close to an obstacle or whether it has approached the object of interest. So for those purposes, you have the proximity sensor. In some cases, you may want to use accelerometers, which here in this case, you can have a, this is a three axis accelerometer. So in these three axes, the acceleration is measured, okay, an IC based accelerometer. And the usage of this is in cases where you want to know the acceleration, or basically you want to know the orientation of the robot itself, okay, orientation with respect to Earth or something like that. Okay. Going further, you can also measure, you can also have sensors that measure, instead of the position, it can measure velocity, like tachometers. Okay. An example of such a sensor would be a directional optical encoder. Okay. Where now there are two disks here. They have their own light and dark patterns, but they are offset. So what you have is a sequence that goes something like 00, 01, 11, and 10. Okay. So depending upon whether the sequence goes in this direction or this direction, you know the direction of motion of the disk, or and in and consequently the robotic link. And the frequency at which this cycling is happening will determine the speed of the motion. Okay, so that is as far as the sensors are concerned. Let's then look into the muscle, the actuation of the robot. Okay, so whenever you have a robot, you want a task to be accomplished, you need some power, some mechanism by which the power can be transmitted to the joints or wheels or legs of a robot. The actuation mechanism is basically the system by which this is done. The more popular modes of actuation are electrical, hydraulic, and pneumatic actuation, basically in the same sequence of popularity. So let's basically look in brief into what an actuation system is. Okay, so there is a signal, there is an actuation signal that is coming from the controller that I had mentioned earlier. Okay, now this signal usually is not of a high power, it's a low power electrical signal. Okay. And to convert into a high power electrical signal, you need an amplifier, a circuit that increases the power to a high power electrical signal. Okay, and this basically is fed into a motor. Now you have a high speed mechanical signal. So now the motor moves at high speed, and so this in the actuator, the actuation motor is moving at a high speed, but you don't really require the robotic arm to move at a high speed. You want the robotic arm to move at a low speed, but delivering enough force or enough torque. Okay, so though this motor is of a high speed device, okay, it has a low torque. Okay, so you need to increase the torque, so you need a transmission mechanism for it. So the most usually used transmitter, most commonly used transmission mechanism is a gear train. So by using the set of an amplifier, a actuation system, a motor, and a transmission system like a gear train, you can convert the low power electrical signal from the controller into a high torque mechanical signal that can be fed into the, so that can be given to the joint of the robot. Okay, so let's now look very briefly into each of these different actuation systems. Okay, of course, the electrical actuation system is basically an electrical motor that may be a stepper motor, a DC motor, or an AC motor. Okay, depending upon the specific application, the appropriate motor can be chosen. Okay, and because electrical power supply is quite widespread, electrical actuation is quite power efficient, and because electrical systems can be turned on and off very quickly, the accuracy is also quite high. In comparison to other actuation systems like hydraulic actuation system, there is no other fluid that is being utilized, so electrical actuation systems are generally quite clean and quiet, and they are lightweight, and the maintenance is also easy. So it seems that this is a solution to all the problems. However, it has its own downsides. Okay, whenever as since the motors are being used, in almost all cases you cannot connect the joint of the robot directly to the motor. You need a mechanical transmission mechanism by which the low torque output can be converted to a high torque output. Okay, since there is another motor that has to be added, it usually adds mass to the robot, and it has its own, because the supply is electrical, and electrical motors don't scale up very well, not good at scaling up. Okay, so when you want to do heavy lifting, or robots that can that are that basically need to operate, apply high lot of torque or a lot of force, the electrical motors is not a solution. Electrical actuators are not a solution. You need to go for other modes. Particularly, you need to go for hydraulic actuators. Okay, so as the name implies, a hydraulic actuator has a pressurized fluid as the means of transmitting power or transmitting power. Okay, so as it can be seen in this figure, okay, there are two ports here, and by pumping in fluid in the appropriate port, this shaft can be made to move appropriately in the correct direction or to the correct extent also. Okay, and usually what we are using are fluid like oils, which are generally incompressible. So precise control is also possible in such hydraulic actuators, and this is a figure of a hydraulic actuator system. Basically, it has four components in it. One is a reservoir that houses this whatever fluid, whatever oil that is being used. Okay, there is a pump here which pumps the oil into the actuator. Okay, there are valves which direct the direction in which this oil has to flow. Okay, and of course the actuator here that does all the job. In fact, in this figure, there are actually two actuators. One is here and one is here. Okay, if you look closely, you would see that both of them are acting in a similar manner. Okay, they cycle through two modes of operation. One mode in which because of the valves, the fluid flows in one direction. In another mode, the fluid flows in the opposite end of the what do you call of the actuator. Okay, so these are hydraulic actuator systems, and as I said earlier, because of the incompressibility of the fluid, the accurate control can be given in the hydraulic actuator setup also, and they are quite speedy also. Okay, and due to the incompressibility, you also have a low backlash, So, which is a problem. Backlash is a problem that you can, you would see in electrical actuators because of the gear train. Okay, and here there is no gear train that is required, no mechanical linkages that is required. So, because of that, the actuation system is a bit simpler, and large forces can be delivered also. But then all is not good. Because of the oil, or because it requires a fluid, okay, it requires maintenance. This fluid is also can has temperature dependent properties, like viscosity can change with temperature. So if the actuator is being, if the robot is being used in an environment in which temperature changes significantly, or either it goes down significantly or it goes up significantly, then the efficiency of the actuator reduces a lot. Okay, there is a fire risk since there is an oil involved. Okay, and these sort of hydraulic actuators are generally used for large operations, so they don't scale down well. The electrical actuators were not scaling up well, and hydraulic actuators don't scale down properly. Okay, so each of these, we can see that each of these actuators has its own pros and cons, and because of that, the usage, the choice of the actuators should be application specific. Okay, so the third type, or the third popular type, is a pneumatic actuator where you use compressed air as the fluid, and because you are using air and you are compressing it also, the one thing is that you don't need a reservoir because air is abundant, so you need not have any system by which you can hold your holding air. So there is no reservoir. However, for the same reason that you are compressing air, you need a dehumidifier, an air conditioning unit in your pneumatic actuator system. The reason for that is that when you compress air, the moisture in the air is going to condense, and if the moisture gets into the components of the actuator itself, and the actuator, if it has metal components in it, then rusting is one of the problems. So you need a dehumidifier in a pneumatic actuator. Okay, and now coming to the pros and cons of these actuators, of the pneumatic actuators, you can see that because the bulk, the all you need is a compressor, that is the only component that really needs power in the pneumatic actuator. Okay, so this will be one of the cheapest options of an actuator. Air is abundantly available, it can't catch fire. Okay, and like the hydraulic actuators, the pneumatic actuator also doesn't require any mechanical transmission. However, because of the compressibility, precise control is not possible. Okay, and because of the same reason for the compressibility, it is not able to apply as much force as an hydraulic actuator can apply. So this is not useful for heavy loads. Okay, and it actually needs a separate dehumidifier so that the moisture present in the air doesn't rust your actuation system itself. Okay, but the response of a pneumatic actuator is generally fast. So instead of precise control, pneumatic actuator can be used for fast acting switches. Now if you want to close or open something very quickly, then pneumatic actuators could be used in that context. Okay, so we have seen both sensors and actuators. Let's go into the third component, the controllers. Okay, so the sensor data needs to be appropriately processed, and the appropriate signal needs to be given to the actuators. The controller basically does this job. So basically, it is the logic by which the sensor signal is interpreted and appropriate action is sent to the actuator. Okay. Now let us see into what different ways can the control act. The simplest way is an error-based control, okay, which is displayed here. An example is a PID control, which is also called as a proportional integral derivative control. Okay, I half expect some of you to have come across this control, but anyway, what the basic philosophy is that you are at certain position, the robot's position is at one point and it has to go to another point. Okay, so there is an error between these two and drawn it from. Okay. So let us say it is at one, it has to go here. It's at one, it has to go to the error is something and I want to move in this direction. An appropriate control signal has to be given so that it goes in this direction, goes from the initial position to the desired position. Okay, and what it operates on is the error between these two positions, and appropriate control action is taken. So you have the desired position here, you have the actual position here, the error is taken in, fed through that, okay, fed through different blocks. One of those blocks is actually proportional to the error signal, one of those blocks takes the derivative of the error signal, one of those blocks integrates the error signal and appropriately combines, and an appropriate control signal is generated and given to the actuator of the robot. Okay, and again the cycle continues until this is happening. Okay, now this seems simple enough, but if I want to go from point A to point B, is it so simple? Is it so straightforward? There are multiple ways to go. Okay, so it's not just, the problem doesn't stop simply because the problem is not completely explained by just specifying that go to B from A. Okay, the problem cannot be simplified to this extent. Probably in certain applications it is necessary to also specify what is the trajectory that is to be taken, okay, that is to be followed. Okay, like in an assembly line. Okay, it's not enough that the robot's end effector goes from point A to point B. There is a certain sequence, certain path it has to be taken, certain sequence of points that the end effector has to approach so that the operation is done properly. Okay, so there is an error, and also even when the path is followed perfectly, let us say that I want this particular path to be followed, and when I try, I am following this path. Okay, the question is, what should be the actuation signal? Okay, it's not that if the error is zero, then too there is an actuation signal. Okay, and there should be another component which reduces the error is zero. So there is actuation signal for maintaining error as zero plus another actuation signal to get error to zero. Okay, There are two components in this. The first one is the expectation part, and the second one is the error part. So control algorithm that use both of these are basically calculating or computing torque that has to be applied. Okay, so you have algorithms like computer torque control, which take into account a desired trajectory on top of maintaining on top of reducing the error of the actual robot's trajectory from the desired trajectory. Okay. Now both of these two basically control position, okay, based on position information. I have to go from point A to point B. I move from point A to point B. Okay, but remember the case of the iPod. Okay, you had to go from point A to point B in this direction. Okay, so that was computer torque control or PID that could be used there. Okay, but while plugging in, it was not, the problem was not to move the plug by a certain distance. The problem was to plug this wire, this cable, into the iPod properly, which means that move until appropriate force is applied. So you have four sensors here that detect what, how much reaction force is being applied, and the position control is done based on force. Okay, so you have a force sensor, and which says that the position of the robot is being controlled using the force sensors. An example of that is an impedance control mechanism, okay, where you create a virtual impedance, you create the forces, you model the forces as if they are virtual impedances, and appropriate actuation signal is generated by the controller. Okay, so these are the various control philosophies that can be applied in control of a robot. Okay, so let's see, let's end this one with a video of a collaborative assembly of a furniture, of a chair. This was this research done at School of Mechanical and Aerospace Engineering at NTU Singapore. Okay, so you have cameras in the hands of these two robots, so they are able to see where the pegs are, and due to appropriate control they are able to again locate where this legs of the robot are being, or not robot, legs of this chair are being placed. Okay, and the pegs are again put in into the chair, okay, using impedance control. Okay, and again now there is a position control happening here by placing the other frame of the chair. Okay, and in here, in this last move, these two robots have to interact, have to talk with one another, so that their motions are synchronized. So that is where the collaboration comes. Okay, and with that, I come to the end of this lecture, and thank you very much.